So my name is Mike Canney. Also with me today is Al Swanky. We're both very young packet analysts, as you can tell by our hair and my beard color. But we've both been kind of in the industry for I think 32 years, and Al's he's got me beat by a few. But one of the things I started out my career as a network engineer, right? So back in my early days, I was working for IBM, doing token ring, OS2 LAN server, and really fell in love with this big lunchbox looking thing. Anybody know what that is? It was called a Dolch that was Network General Sniffer. What was really cool about it is anytime that anybody had a problem, right? You couldn't print. That was like 90% of the help desk calls back then, is someone couldn't print, or you had slow file access over your high-speed wide area network, which happened to be a 56K DDS link, which high speed at the time. But what I loved about the Sniffer was being able to plug that into the network. And back then it was, you know, either token ring, or as Loris and Gerald showed this morning in the keynote, FinNet, 10 base 2, where you actually had to plug into the actual bus and make sure everything was terminated. But that's really kind of how I grew up through the networking, from IBM to Novell to Bay Networks, Wellfleet, Cisco, and really have always spent most of my career looking at packets and understanding why do things work the way they do when things are good, so that when something breaks, I've got a baseline that I can go back to, right? So the first slide here, we'll talk about Tiger Team. How many of you are on Tiger Teams? Have been on a Tiger Team? Basically, where, you know, 9 times out of 10, the call comes into the help desk that the quote unquote network is slow, and thus a Tiger Team form. So in this case, Dilbert is wanting to have a Tiger Team to clean up the room, and he ordered Tiger costumes for everybody. So again, we're going to kind of talk about some of those scenarios where both I or Al and I in the past have gotten involved, either working for a specific company or a vendor, or, you know, my years of consulting, where, you know, everyone's hair's on fire, and you've got your network team over here, your systems team over here, your database team over here, and everybody's going like this, right? All the lights are green. It's not me. Can't be me. Can't be the network. I'm turning around, you know, ping times less than 2 milliseconds. And the system team saying, well, it can't be the system. You know, CPUs at 10% memory looks great, disk IO, but yet users are still having problems. So one of the things we're going to talk about here is packets themselves, and I'll feel free to chime in. But from my perspective, you know, packets are the single source of truth, right? Packets, I look at this as being the fingerprint on the network. If you're kind of doing forensics or CSI, who did what, where did they go, how much data did they transmit, and in a lot of cases, how long did it take, and what was the end user's experience at the end of the day, so that when you're on that Tiger Team, you can get the right person involved, right? If it's a database related issue, for example, where you've got a SQL query that's only pulling back 2 rows of data at a time of a table, and that's taking up 50 seconds out of the 1 minute user transaction, don't get the network team involved, right? So a lot of what we're going to talk about today is getting those clean captures. And what I mean by a clean capture is that, number one, I'm not dropping any packets. And number two, my timestamps are fairly accurate, right? I don't have clock drift. I don't have some of those things, because what we're going to focus on this class today is how do we look at the life of a packet as it leaves the end user's workstation, across the router, across the firewall, across the load balancer, to the server and back. Right? What is the delay that you know, that packet took in both directions all across those devices. How many of you have troubleshot a network-related problem using Wireshark? Pretty much everybody, right? How many of you are using multiple captures to do that? A few? Yeah, so that's really what we're gonna focus on for this session is we've got a number of use cases where it was the network that was causing the problem. And the thing that we needed to figure out is where in the network was that happening, right? Is it the, was it the switch? Was it the router? Was it the firewall? And I've got countless examples of this type of problems that we've troubleshot. And really, if you look at the packet and you're measuring it as it goes across the network, and even if you've got maybe just two captures, one at the client, one at the server, you can tell right away by looking at the time that that packet left to the time that it arrived at the second sniffer. Looking at that delta is going to tell you how long was that on the wire. Likewise, that request hits the server, say it's a web server and it's an HTTP get. The get hits the server, server turns around and sends its either ACK or sends its okay or whatever the code it's going to send back. That delta time between the time it received the request and the time that it answered that request, of course, is going to tell you how long was the server processing that. But by having these multiple captures along the path, it's going to allow us to accurately pinpoint exactly where the problem is.
So having that data, stressing what Mike said, is key. You know, having the multiple data points, capturing it in good clean traces with good time sync as far as time stamping is crucial. And if we have all that data, as Laura said and Gerald alluded to this morning, you've got all the data you need to solve these problems. That's the cool thing about collecting packets on the network. Everything's there. You just have to be able to capture it and have a way of looking at it.
Yeah, exactly. So I often kind of joke and say, you know, it's not rocket science, it's just math. If you can get those clean captures along the path, I'm going to show you some ways that you can do that time synchronization to determine what those different devices may have done to that packet as it traversed the network. And hopefully I'm switching pages here. Wow, this is... it's not changing.
We're having a little challenge switching between the PC screen, PowerPoint, and what's being displayed to you folks. There you go.
Yeah, there we go. Now I think I've got it, but it's not changing on here. So one of my favorite sayings, and it has been for quite a while, because it, you know, as I've run into, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of different problems that I've troubleshot as a consultant for different companies, one of my favorite sayings is, you know, it's not the network, right? And I think I saw somebody wearing a t-shirt earlier, it says it's not the network. And a lot of times we have the ability to, you know, exonerate the network, right? Prove that it's not, prove that in that case of, you see the request go in, you see, you know, 15 seconds later, the reply come back out, you can determine, hey, it's a server problem, until it is. And in some cases, that three of these different use cases, we're gonna show the ability and capabilities within Wireshark to be able to follow those traces, find it and fix it. So for example, if we've got packet loss, so let's say I'm taking I've got a Wireshark trace on my laptop and I'm going out to XYZ, my bank, or I'm going out to Amazon.com or Best Buy and everything's really slow. And I take a trace file and I see packet loss. Well, when I have that one specific capture, that just tells me that between my laptop and some point in the internet, packets were dropped. So one of the use cases we're going to look at for the first scenario here is going out to an internet-based app, and that could be a SaaS-based application. It could be you at home going out over your home internet, capturing on the outside of your firewall and capturing on your laptop, and being able to determine very quickly where that packet loss is coming. So some of the things that you might find, and or that we found is First of all, faulty or buggy equipment. Yes, I'm sure it's not a surprise to most of you that even the tier one network equipment manufacturers still sometimes let out bugs. Or we'll see in one of the other scenarios, a misconfigured load balancer and how that could impact traffic on the network. So one of the things that we're going to talk about here is, multiple captures allow you to pinpoint network device issues. And I kind of went over this a little bit already. But again, if you have clean captures, meaning no drop packets, timestamps are reliable, typically when I'm doing this, depending on how fast the network is it a gigabit laptop, or is it a 10 gig or 40 gig or 100 gig backbone, wherever I'm capturing from, be very wary of the sniffer dropping the packets, right? And if you go back to some of the retrospectives from the SharkFest at Carnegie Mellon, had a session on how to identify when the analyzer itself is dropping packets.
And they have good solutions in place to capture those packets, good equipment that can do those line rate captures and handle those bursts of traffic, as Mike spoke to, 10 gig, 40 gig, 100 gig, have the right solution in place. So you have legitimate trace files that have all the packets that we need to troubleshoot these issues.
Exactly. And some of the things that you'll see in depending on the scenario, depending on the network, we may be looking at, for some organizations, 10 or 15 different capture points that we're synchronizing, really, really dependent upon the task and the organization's network. And as you can imagine, that can be quite expensive, but there's definitely means with packet brokers and those types of things where you can move, or you've got capture devices with multiple 10 gig, 100 gig, 40 gig interfaces, 1 gig interfaces, again, depending on it. And the ability to just take a single capture box and do multiple PCAPs from a single box, right? So interface one is right now the inside of the firewall, interface two is right in the outside of the firewall, interface three is writing in front of the WAN optimizer, interface four is on the outside of the WAN optimizer, and then have the ability to pull that back. So,
and separate that information that you specifically know that that's inside outside off that same appliance by something like Q and Q, as far as an additional VLAN tags, that came in from the inside of the network versus the outside. So having those right solutions in place from a visibility perspective, presenting that to your packet analyzer is crucial.
So the first example here we're going to start out with is a really kind of simple architecture, right? So it was an end user. They were at a branch location of a company. And essentially we loaded up Wireshark on the end user's workstation. And then we captured on the outside of the firewall. And in this case, what you can see, if we start looking at the different timestamps in those two traces, and usually what we're using for the calculation and synchronization. And again, I will say, I'll preface this with, this is kind of not scientific merging of trace files like some commercial analyzers do. This is, again, it's looking at using Wireshark. So we're not, and my point is that this method that I'm going to show you today is accurate for problems typically, but it's not microsecond accuracy, right? Because of we're really just dealing with the clocks on the two different capture machines and lining those up based on relative time of a matching packet of a specific TCP socket. So in this case, we see a GET go out, we see it arrive on the other side of the firewall, then we see the reply go back, and we see the reply go through the firewall. So looking at the deltas in those two trace files is going to allow us to understand how much impact did this firewall have on this traffic. So what's in common between the trace files? How do we go about synchronizing these? Well, the first one that that is my typical go-to, again, without knowing much about the customer network, is looking for the raw TCP sequence number, right? So if I've got a capture on the inside and a capture on the outside, depending what that device is, if it's a firewall, it probably will NAT it. If it's a proxy or an applications gateway, it might regenerate the entire header on the other side. But for most instances, I'm looking at sequence number as being one of the identifiers. And then another is the IP ID. So what the IP identifier is going to allow us to do, especially in a scenario where we've got retransmissions, right? Where you're retransmitting through a firewall and it retransmits 2, 3, 4 times, depending on the OS. Each one of those retransmissions is going to have a separate or new IP identifier. So what we're looking for is we're looking for that original request, right? Or in this case, a GET. We're looking for that GET, or we're looking for the, you know, the SYN packet of that connection and the sequence number in the other trace. And we'll walk through this in Wireshark and I'll show you how to do it. But those two are the kind of the low-hanging fruit. And a lot of times people say, well, what about, you know, proxies, or if the entire socket is modified or changed or regenerated on an applications gateway or a proxy, then what you can do is use the contains filter within Wireshark. How many people use the contains filter? Yeah, there's a few hands out there. The contains filter is awesome, primarily because if there's nothing really in common from a sequence number or an IP ID or even, you know, IP addresses, et cetera, you can use a contains filter on both of those traces for looking for payload that you know that is in the client trace or the inside. And if we're looking inside and outside, the inside trace, for example, maybe I would look for a transaction ID, or I would look for a username if they're logging in, and then take that same contains filter, put that on the outside capture. And then once we found that frame, because the contains filter is going to show you the individual packet, then what we'll do is we'll right click on it and do a TCP conversations filter, so it'll show both of the sockets, and then we can do our synchronization from there. And the last bullet here is one of the ways that we do this with the kind of the poor man's way of synchronization is finding the first frames in common, set the relative packet packet times the same.
Mike's going with this is, once again, just armed with Wireshark and a few capture points, getting some good packets, you can solve this problem. He's going to show you right now.
And I'm going to show you how to do it. So this is what I call kind of the ultimate goal of the life of a packet. So what you're looking at here is these, you know, there could be 4 devices. It could be routers, it could be firewalls, it could be switches, could be anything that, you know, touches the network or possibly queues it or forwards it. And so what we're looking at is where each one of those arrows are, we're looking at having a capture point. So we had, you know, Wireshark or you know, pick your favorite capture device. Each one of those arrows is going to be a capture. And then what we're going to do is we're going to synchronize the inside and outside, the inside and outside, the inside and outside, the inside and outside, and plot this, in this case, on a scatter chart. And you could do this. There's some tools that do this, but you could also do something similar to this if you've got some Excel skills. But essentially what we're doing, and in this case, we can tell right away. So the blue is the transit time outside. The red is the transit time inside. So in this case, what we can tell right away, let's say, for example, we've got really slow delays of a web page loading, or you know, sometimes the page loads, sometimes it doesn't. By having these captures instrumented, the goal is to very quickly be able to look at that data set and say, yeah, it's that, you know, it's that router, you know, in this case, the third box, because we see the huge transit times from the inside to the outside. Any questions on this so far? Make sense? Okay, cool. So yeah, the struggle is real. This is actually Ken McClelland. Ken is from my hometown. He got second place in the world's strongman competition. And he is, or was, my daughter's personal trainer. So I had to put that in there. But the you know, when I say the struggle is real, what I'm looking at is in the real world, right? And you're going to see some real world traces that we've, you know, that I've anonymized, thanks to Jasper and Trace Wrangler. But you're going to see some real world traces. But in some of these severe environments, so for example, the I won't give anything away, but the last scenario that we're going to talk about was a Microsoft Teams issue, where the company was having all kinds of communications problems right in the middle of the pandemic, where everybody was working from home and nobody could have meetings and everything was just dying on the vine. And so in those cases, we're looking at millions, if not billions, of packets, right? So how do you handle that one by one in a Wireshark, right? It's very, it becomes quite a challenge. And this is where, you know, some of the other tools out there that do this are in some cases necessity, but we're also going to talk about some of the other ways we can do this synchronization. So the second bullet here is, and what we've been doing with the Exedian technology is generating synthetic transactions that represent, so for example, that represents Microsoft Teams audio traffic, right? So you can create a Teams packet at UDP port 3478, and I can send just a little burst of that through the network and have my captures filtered just for that pseudo Teams traffic to understand again what the network devices are doing when people are complaining, right? So having that synthetic transaction, capturing those with Wireshark or any capture devices is going to make those trace files a lot smaller. Alternatively, what you could do is you could take smaller samples, right? But unfortunately, again, in today's environments, especially at 10 gig line rate, you're gonna reach the end of your theoretical limit of analyzing in Wireshark, because that trace file for like 5 seconds is going to be 2 gigabytes. So in that case, get creative with either some type of open source or some product that can do the synthetic transaction generation, and just capture that traffic specifically. And then lastly, I'd mentioned this already, but being able to go into Wireshark and export the summary windows in CSV format, and you can use the, it's going to export what your display is. So if you've got, your relative time set to 0 on the first matching packets, you can pull both of those CSVs in, and you can take the two columns and you can, subtract one from the other and get a really good idea of systematic or really chronic type of problems. So this brings us to our first scenario here. And this is, again, very a simplified case, but it was very eye-opening for me and from a consulting perspective, because the common complaint was the internet's slow. And you would ask, well, is it a specific website or was it, and it came back again. How many of you heard or got a help desk ticket or something forwarded to you that, hey, the network is slow or the internet is slow, and that's all you have to go on? So what we did first here is we captured at the client. And again, here's what was reported: periodically slow web pages. Again, looking at the SNMP tools that they had in place, 5-minute averages look great. Nothing was overloaded.
Everything's green, folks. The NAC is saying it's not our problem, but we have end users screaming. So we've got to get to the bottom of this, get to the packets.
Yeah. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and stop my share here, and I'm going to walk you through how we synchronize those two trace files. So again, we had one on the inside, or from the customers, the client users workstation, And then our second trace was outside the firewall. So how do I stop sharing here?
The beauty of Wireshark is we can solve these problems, alleviate the pain, get the root cause. And as Michael showed you, this is a great trace file that he's going to be showing you here as far as the inside and outside.
Maybe I just have to kill this. I apologize.
Bear with us.
I'm not new to PowerPoint. It's okay, let me go ahead and do another share here.
Yes, having some in place, once again, can't stress it enough, for the crucial points within your network to have that visibility is necessary, in my opinion, in a big way. I've seen in so many organizations where, you know, having that multiple trace files just nailed it and took away all speculation. And to Mike's point, that, you know, the NOC team, the server, web tier, security teams, all on a triage call, and if we just look at the packets, we can eliminate that and say, hey, we know it's a network. Guys, go back to your jobs.
Yeah, so what I have here is I've got the trace file that we took from the client's perspective. And I will kind of try to make this interactive because I know it's afternoon and this is not the most exciting stuff in the world, but to me, it's exciting. So what do we see here? All right, so in the beginning, we see the three-way handshake. And that was 14 milliseconds. And then we see a get that's basically just going out for this PMG. And then we see a retrans, a retrans, a retrans, a retrans, a retrans, a retrans. This is really, the system was really trying hard to get this load, you know, this web page loaded. So 11 seconds later was our last retransmission. Then all of a sudden, 20 seconds later, we got an ACK and then a 304. It came back from the web server. What's the problem here? Well, this was the issue that, you know, that the customer specifically had is they're like, you know, yeah, we need to call our carrier, right? We need to call our service provider. Your internet's bad. So again, what we did here was to capture outside the firewall, and I'll show you this trace. So outside the firewall, you can see all the IP addresses are NATed. And so our goal is to pull out that end user's transaction that we got from the client trace and filter this backend traffic so that we can see what was going on outside the firewall. So one of the things, again, that I mentioned earlier is that we can look for the raw sequence number. So what I typically will do is I'll go to this first SYN packet and go down to TCP and find the raw sequence number. And then what I'm going to do here, little trick, right click on it, prepare this as a filter, selected, and then now you see it populated here. Now I could have typed this out if I was, but I'm kind of lazy. I didn't want to have to remember that sequence number. This is much easier. So I'll highlight that, right click on this, copy it, and then come into the firewall trace and come in and paste this. And hopefully I find that sequence number, and I do. So in this case, you can see the clock or the time in this capture was 57 seconds into the firewall trace, right? So at 57 seconds and 0 seconds. So one of the things I want to do here to begin my synchronizations, and now I found that one single packet, is right click on this and do a TCP conversation filter. So what this is going to do is it's going to show me the outside socket on that firewall that matches the inside socket. So I do that, and now I can see what's going on the outside. So what do we see here, guys? A SYN, SYN-ACK, ACK. First, what I'm going to do is I'm going to right click on this first packet that's in common, and I'm going to set a time reference. So what that does is it resets that relative clock to zero. So now, again, this is kind of that non-scientific pseudo, what we used to call Minnesota math. I'm not picking on anybody from Minnesota, but let's call it Minnesota math, where it's not synchronized to the millisecond, but it gives us an idea and can show us specifically what's going on here. So we see the three-way handshake. How long did that take from the client's perspective? Oh, about 3 microseconds, very quick. And then what do we see? We see 20 seconds later, we see a GET leave the firewall. What's going on here? Anybody have a guess? What about all those other retransmissions that we saw on the client side? Why don't we see those outside the firewall? Well, let's figure out which GET this actually is, right? So outside the firewall, we see that happens 20 seconds into the trace. Which GET is this? Well, what we can do is look specifically at the, in this case, I'm going to use the IP identifier. So my IP ID for this is 3776. So that's the unique IP identifier for this packet. And now if I go back to this trace and I look at the first GET that went out, and let me minimize this and go into the IP header, 3776. Well, let's look at the next one just to make sure that we understand how IP IDs work. The next one in line, the first retransmission was 3807. Second retransmission was 3826. It's incrementing like we expect it to. But this GET arrived at the firewall 14 milliseconds, almost 15 milliseconds into the time that user hit enter. The GET was at the firewall, it was there. 20 seconds later, it left the firewall. All these other retransmissions, of course, were for naught because it already had the firewall had already received a GET. So it just ignored those retransmissions. And then 20 seconds later, the firewall decides to let that out the backside. So the GET hit the firewall 14 milliseconds into the transaction. 20 seconds later, it left the firewall. So where's our bottleneck? Is it the internet? Do we need to call our carrier? In this case, no, we need to fix the firewall. It's queuing packets upwards of 20 seconds. Now, just kind of complete and finish this story. It was a new firewall that they had just purchased. They had plugged it in. I'm not going to mention the name.
No bugs? Come on.
No bugs in this specific instance. But no, it was a firmware problem that randomly the firewall would just sit there. It wasn't dropping the packets, which I guess was good. But, you know, this is where their source of internet delays were. It was this firewall. So again, you can do this type of synchronization for any amount of different devices, right? So let's say I've got a network where I've got 15 devices, or maybe I don't even know the hops in between point A and point B, but I have access to capture a trace at point A and capture a trace at point B. One of the things that you can do is determine the baseline propagation delay or determine the latency by looking at the three-way handshake, right? We've all kind of learned that probably, and it's been pounded over and over in the SharkFest class probably, and in most of the classes that talk about performance. But you can look at the baseline latency. And if you want to get really nerdy, you can look at the packet size and calculate insertion delay based on the bandwidth that's available, or the minimum bandwidth in the path. But just in these simple cases, I can look at my point A and my point B, and there's, you know, or my point A to point Z, and there's 23 steps in between. But if I look at those two furthermost outside instances, so let's say, for example, you've got a complex network where you've got multiple hops or multiple devices between the user's workstation and your internet connection. Well, if I capture at the egress of my network, right, on the outside of my internet firewall, and I capture at the user's workstation, regardless if there's, you know, 15 or 20 different hops in between them, I can synchronize those two. And I can tell you right away if you've got a transit problem, right? Because with this, you can actually calculate this type of synchronization. You can calculate how long was that packet on the wire? How long did it take to get through your network?
In your domain that you control.
Yes. Question, yes. Yeah, so I believe the question was, is when you're taking these traces, do you have to take them at the same time? Yeah, you do, because the key to this is that you want to have frames in common, right? So when I've got frames in common, I can look at the time that the packet left, I can look at the time that the packet arrived, do the delta of that to tell you if you have a network problem, right? Yeah, so normally I don't do that at the beginning. So the question was, if you've got this complex network where you've got firewall, load balancer, you know, four different hops, if you will, that you should or could capture from, do you have to do that every time? And the answer to that is no. And that's where I'll usually take the furthest most point outside the network and as close as I can get to that user or that device that's having the problem and just take two captures. And then when I synchronize those two, if I have a problem, right, if I have a huge delay from, you know, let's say my baseline propagation delay should be 4 milliseconds to get from my client to my internet egress. And all of a sudden I'm seeing when I'm synchronizing these trace, it's like 400, 500, 600 milliseconds or multiple seconds to get through the network. Then what I do is I start stepping backwards. So I take a trace that was at the client and I move that to in front of the internet firewall and I test that. And if that's good, then I move it back one and I test that. And if that's good, I move it back. So you don't have to do them all at the same time. I will say that, you know, when I come in from a, you know, consulting perspective, a lot of times it depends on the urgency of the problem. And quite often it's, I'm coming in 3 months, 6 months, they've had the problem and they need to get it resolved tomorrow or, you know, if they're going to start replacing people. So usually what we come in armed for bear and we capture everywhere and just do it once, especially if they're intermittent issues, right? So if it's a problem that happens like once every Tuesday, if it's a full moon, you know, those weird gray issues that show up, go away, come back. I want to make sure that I've captured the problem when it occurs instead of waiting 2 weeks for it to happen again.
Yeah, then so good question. You might have a tool that allow you to go back in time for when, you know, the trouble tickets open to say, oh, it happened 2 hours ago. And I have those tools in place where I can go to that window of time for each capture point.
Yeah, that's a really good point. If you've got, you know, which most organizations should have some type of long-term packet capture so you can forensically go back. That's a good point. Yes. Yeah, so that's a fantastic question. So the question was, if we want to capture on the outside of a firewall, can we use the capture capability of the firewall, like a TCP dump or a PCAP related issue? My take on that is if you can't tap it, then do that. But if you can tap it, then tap it, because I've seen this a lot with different network vendors and manufacturers. A lot of it depends. If that firewall is being hammered, what'll happen is a lot of times those timestamps will get skewed. So it won't be that clean capture that I'm talking about. So it's best to either, you know, tap it if you can, span it if you have to, or the other result is to take the capture off the device. Any other questions?
It's a great lead into where Mike's taking us next. Some further in depth to everyone's questions here, multi-hop, true multi-hop And as Mike spoke to, going backwards and finding the component where the problem resides, and you know how to do that within Wireshark.
So let me go ahead and I hit escape. Oh yeah, there we go. Cool. I'm getting the hang of this. I'm getting the hang of this Zoom. Okay. Hopefully you can all still see that on Zoom. So what happened here, right? So if we look at, boy, just that I jinxed myself.
We're just trying to put it onto the Zoom site, folks. It's a great.
There we go.
There you go. Cool.
So again, just to kind of rehash what happened in that last trace, is we see a get go out, we see a retrans, we see a retrans, retrans, retrans. 20 seconds later, the get leaves the back of the firewall. And the way that we determined that get that left the firewall was the original get was looking at the IP identifier. It's not on Zoom. Oh. I don't know why this is goofy. Is it on Zoom now? Okay, perfect. Thank you for that. I'm going to struggle this whole. I just know I'm going to struggle this whole session with Zoom. So again, so that's what happened, and you know what we were able to show on Wireshark.
Man, once again, solving difficult problems with Wireshark. You have the tool. Just understand where you have to go and what you have to look at to once again align, synchronize those trace files in the data, really, to understand what's happening inside versus outside. Is there any online questions while we're waiting here?
Okay. So the next, the one we're going to talk about is the white screen, the screen bleed, and the big blue internet of death.
I love the screen bleed. Mike, I wasn't involved with this one. This is one of his traces, and I've never heard that before, but he's got an example.
It's great. Yeah, so it's kind of a funny little joke behind this, and anybody that works with end users will probably get a kick out of it. But anybody heard this? Let's move it to the cloud. I mean, that 4 years ago, this was something some people were thinking about, but it is pretty commonplace today, or at least SaaS-based applications. So one of the key issues that we run into in IT is if we move a resource to essentially somebody else's network, you lose all visibility, right? So, and guess what happens when a problem occurs? You know, the vendor immediately accepts responsibility and says, yeah, it's us, I'm sorry, right?
Not.
No, not at all. So here's what was reported. So this is what we were getting at the help desk. We're getting many white screens. The screen is bleeding. The big blue internet is slow. And the automated dialer connects, but screen sometimes doesn't display. So anybody have any idea what the big blue internet would be that is slow? Edge browser, Microsoft browser. So that literally. So the point to this specific slide is as network analysts and network engineers, when we're troubleshooting these problems, one of the most common things I see on these tiger teams, and again, just from an outside perspective, looking at problems that organizations are having, is that oftentimes problems are reported that have nothing to do with what actually is going on. So one of the things I always recommend when you get one of these, you know, 911, SEV1 type problems, and this, you know, the big tiger team gets formed and everybody's all hands on deck, you know, teleconference nailed up 24/7, paging you out in the middle of the night,
is to really step back and understand what the user is seeing. So in this specific instance, you wouldn't believe what they were troubleshooting, from a group, because naturally all the tools that everyone was using, the monitoring of the network, the monitoring of the database, the monitoring of throughput, bandwidth utilization, everything was great. All the lights were green, but yet users were kept with these different problems being reported. And so what I recommend and what I actually did for this specific user was actually go out and sat with the user. So sat with the user for about 5 to 6 hours and actually see what a screen bleed is, what a white screen is, what the big blue internet is. And so that I can understand when that problem occurs, gives me an idea of where I need to look. And what we also did during this specific time is we took trace files from the user's perspective. So we loaded up PCAP on the end user's workstation and set up a ring buffer. And every time the problem occurred, they took a screenshot, they put it in a Word document, a little bit of a description of, you know, what they were working on, who they were talking to. So when we went back forensically to look at those trace files, specifically from the user's perspective, we had a really good idea of what they were seeing on the screen, right? So I know some organizations, they actually will do screen records, right? And I think there's some tools out there that do this as well, that will actually record what the user sees, because it helps so much to understand like where the specific problem is. So for example, in this case where we saw the white screens, essentially what was happening is it was a web-based application and different portions of the screen would load, right? So depending on what the application was fetching or what it was getting, some of those panels or some of those boxes would come back with the data that they expected, but others were just white, right? No data was actually retrieved. So when we looked at the end user's trace file and we looked at the HTTP decode, we could see very quickly how that page was loading and specifically where it was failing, and more importantly, how it was failing. And we'll look at an example of trace file. So I've kind of rebuilt this problem. And when I get to the solution here, you may have this in your organization, you don't know it. And you'll see why when we get to the traces. But essentially, again, what we did here is we took three captures. We took one from the MPLS network, we took one on the other side of the proxy server, and we took one on the outside of the DMZ, and this was a SAST-based application, right? So the goal here was to determine when this problem occurred, where was it? Was it our network? Was it outside the network? Is it the SAST vendor's fault, et cetera? So the goal was always to let's exonerate the network first, if we can. And then if it's not, we'll look at from the outside of the firewall to the SAST-based application. So let me show you the actual trace files.
And the beauty of having these trace files is that being a SAST-based vendor, if it was towards their network, we'd have a trace file to exonerate our scenario. But if it's in our network, as Mike's talked to, we can once again do that binary search working with Wireshark to move back within our network to find out what component was causing the problems.
Okay, so let's look at the user's trace. So this is our, and again, this is heavily sanitized and filtered out to an extent. So this was a part of that white screen or that page not loading. And what we can see here is we see basically a three-way handshake attempting to get set up, retransmitted three times, and it fails. So this specific object of the page that we're looking for didn't load. So then what we did is we pulled in the capture from the proxy server. So that we're doing kind of two steps at a time here, one for the proxy server, and one from the client, and then we've got one on the outside of the firewall. So again, how do we find this traffic? Well, we do the same thing that we did before. I'm gonna look at for the sequence number. And there's the raw sequence number. I'm gonna prepare this as a filter. And then I'm gonna copy it. And then go back to the proxy capture. And I'm gonna drop that in. Find that send packet. And you could see, oh, we did have three retransmissions. Those passed through the proxy. But let's look at this TCP connection, right? As we always do, go to the conversation filter, pull back the socket, and wait a minute. We've got all kinds of traffic here. And then down here was another send packet at 60 seconds. Or at 171 seconds. So actually we see a fin ACK at 60.4 seconds into this trace. Everybody follow this? So what I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna right click on this and I'm gonna set a time reference. So I'm setting that time to zero, right? When we got the fin is now zero. When did the next connection request that failed, by the way, the next three-way handshake that was for this specific socket, how long from the fin to the new connection? 110 seconds. Anybody have an idea of why that connection didn't get set up? What happens from a TCP state after to that connection to that socket when a fin goes up? What's the next state that thing goes into?
You do a netstat in the command shell on your Windows box. What do you see pop up?
Well, I'll answer it for you. It's fin wait. So again, part of the mechanism that prevents reusing or hijacking of connections is that when that connection closes, that socket, that four pair, the IP address pair, the source and destination port that form that socket, that goes into a fin wait. So in Microsoft, that's typically a fin wait time of 240 seconds. It can be really anywhere between 30 and 300 seconds. But most of those, most of the deployments, Microsoft, about 240 seconds. So what happened when this next connection came in, tried to set up a connection at a port that was in fin wait. Why do you think that might happen? Again, remember the layout of this network. We've got a client going to a proxy that goes to a firewall / DMZ and then goes out to the internet. Well, let's look at this. I've got a diagram here. That'll actually show, hopefully it'll show what happened. So we've got two PCs on the left-hand side. I'm gonna stand up for this one. So we've got PC at 172.23.150.142, and it's using 443 as the destination port, and it's using 54.222 as the ephemeral port. And we've got PC number two that's at 172.23.49.136, different IP address. 443, the TLS port, but it's also using ephemeral port of 54.222. What's that proxy server gonna do in this case that could possibly cause us a problem where this guy can't set up a connection? Yeah, go ahead and advance it. So we see there's an open transaction from PC number one. And then we see this SYN packet that goes out that never gets a response. Go ahead and build that out now. We see it retransmit again. We see it retransmit a third time. And meanwhile,
up in this connection here, this is open, running perfectly. What happens to the source IP address when it gets NATed? Can you see the problem yet? This worked, would have been fine had it not been NATed behind, right? So because this is a different socket than this. But when it gets NATed to a source IP on the back end of 172.30.25.221, and it's going to the same destination IP address, which is the web server, that 199.128, the port, the ephemeral port in this load balancer or in this proxy server was just getting forwarded. So it wasn't regenerating the ephemeral port on the backside, it was just passing it through. So this guy was happy, sends a fin off that. The web server, who essentially set the fin, took the server socket of 172.30.225.221 with 443.54.222 and the other end of that pair of 199.115.76.128 using the same ephemeral port. This guy was in fin wait. So as you can see here, again, the good news and bad news about TCP and the use of ephemeral ports is that you can have this type of, depending on how many users you may have in your environment. And if you've got your load balancer set up just to forward, you know, the TCP ports that it sees from the client, you can run into this problem and you will. Yes, question? Yeah, let's go ahead and handle the question.
The question is, would you suggest working with capture pairs, meaning taking a capture from different endpoints multiple times, or getting it from all endpoints all at once?
That's a fantastic question. So what we did in this specific scenario was we identified a group of super users. Anybody know what a super user is? They're the people that complain all the time, right? They're always calling in and complaining. So we put them to work for us. So in this case, what we did is we took a handful of users. And I think in the first instance of it, we had 5 users that were doing this documentation that I was talking about. So when a problem occurred, they took a screenshot, they had a Word doc, we had captures running on their machine. So in the case of these really big organizations, like some of you may work for, where you've got, you know, hundreds of thousands of users, it's not realistic to do it for all of them, unless you have a huge capture budget, or a dedicated team of you know, packet response engineers. So to answer that question, I would recommend a small number. Again, it depends on how prevalent the problem is. So can I reproduce this issue? If I can't reproduce this issue, I'll grab probably 4 or 5 users that'll be running these transactions and doing the documentation. So it makes it more manageable to do the synchronizations with a fewer. And sometimes what we also did find is we ran into problems that weren't really problems, if that makes any sense. So to, you know, kind of keep from getting sent on, you know, wild goose chase.
Scope creep, huh?
Yeah, exactly. Hunting down, you know, a problem with March Madness, right? Instead of this key application, which has happened to me several times, not just March Madness, but when I worked and lived in Florida, it was, you know, it's the kind of showing my age, but the space shuttle launches or something, people were watching and they knew if they complained about this key critical application that they'd get attention right away. So it really depends. Oh my gosh. Still? To tell you. Let me
me try one more
thing. A little Zoom problem. We'll get there. Yeah, there with those folks. Yeah, maybe stop sharing.
Yeah, I think we're going to be we're going to just have that Zoom issue. I don't know what the deal is. It's again, it's a newer laptop. I'm probably screwing something up. So I'll go through and build this out. Okay. So the next scenario here is some of the challenges of doing voice and video synchronizations, right? So as you know, Ken, there's no TCP sequence number. There is UDP, things that you can find in common. But this is where things get really more challenging with looking at live user traffic, because there's a lot more of it. And introduces some more significant challenges, not only from a capturing perspective, but also from an analysis perspective. So in this case, what we've got, this is kind of the environment that, or the type of environment we were looking at, where we had a WAN optimization, we had firewalls, we had inside, outside of different routers and different switches. And essentially what was happening here is, they were having horrible Teams issues, right? None of these calls would work. Things were dropping to the point where the C-level team that did these weekly town hall meetings during, again, I think this is during the pandemic. Everybody's working from home. Everybody's relying on Teams. And in this case, what we ended up doing is doing captures. You know, we'd have analyzers at all these points. And again, back to that earlier question, do we, deploy one or do we deploy two? In this case, it was critical enough that we want to have multiple captures. We wanted to eliminate or fingerprint any of the network devices that it could be. So what Microsoft was reporting back, and how many use Teams in here? Oh yeah, quite a few. What Microsoft's solution was reporting back is high latency, right? So they're saying, yeah, you guys are having problems. You're having, you're having latency of 200 or 2,500 milliseconds or 2.5 seconds of latency between workstations and the Teams environment. And that's really kind of the visibility that they had, right? They could look at the network. The network looked good. The all these devices, CPU, memory, they were not overloaded. Everything looked fine. Now, what we did was take captures because we wanted to solve this immediately. They had the ability to do multiple captures. The other thing that I'm doing a lot more now, again, due to the inability the problematic capabilities of doing these large, very large captures. So these trace files, by the way, were, I think, the smallest, and they were running for about 30 minutes. The smallest PCAP file we had was, I want to say, between 15 and 20 gigabytes. So as you can imagine, trying to pull that into Wireshark is very, very slow. It's not designed for that. Along with the ability to, every time I change display filters to try to do some sequencing, it would repaint and it would, everybody knows kind of how it reloads. So this is in the case where you could take a synthetic traffic generator, for example, with the Acedian products, where you could create a Microsoft Teams audio packet or a Microsoft Teams video packet and send small bursts of that through the network and capture those bursts. So as long as you're running those synthetic tests and these kind of small burstiness,
These trace files, you could set up filters for those specific packets that you know that you're generating and that you know that you're sending. And then you can do very easily the synchronization within Wireshark. So these are a couple of different options. And I know there's a number of tools out there that that allow you to do packet crafting. The thing that makes the Acedian really unique is they've got a SFP that has a
FPGA.
Yeah, FPGA module on it. So it's programmable. It can do all kinds of different testing, and you just stick it into the device. So again, we did this multi-point capture. I kind of showed you on the last screen what we did. Now, one of the things I'm introducing here is a product that I use quite a bit called NetData. And what this allows you to do, and you can see I'm graphing out here every single packet and the transit times between the sniffers. So again, as that kind of that PowerPoint that I showed you before, the blue is the inside of the firewall and the red is the outside of the firewall. And they're plotted out on the axes telling you how long it took for that packet to get through the firewall. And that's what these little blue lines are. If you were to zoom in on this, you could actually see that blue line joins packets that are in common. So when we grab just a short amount of data for this transaction, you could see that they were the firewall was queuing this traffic for upwards of a second and a half. In some cases, some examples we had was like 2.5 seconds for an audio packet to get through the firewall. And as you can see, this was happening all the time. Constant problem. When a meeting would fire up, this is what we'd see when we'd synchronize those traces. So again, this is another method of being able to do some of that automatically so that you don't have to do the manual work. You let the tool do the heavy lifting. Now, the exciting news is that there is a SharkFest edition of this tool that I'm talking about that is going to be free. And you can, as of next week, it'll be up on that website and you can download it. And there's several different videos on how to use it, but it's a pretty straightforward product. But it's, again, if you wanna do this and you want to kind of check it out with some of your PCAP files, feel free, it's free, go ahead and download it. The only limitation with the SharkFest edition is that it'll do two traces at a time. So if you've got multiple hops, you'll just have to do multiple synchronizations, which again, still works great. Question? Oh, 5 minutes, okay, thanks. And now I'm gonna turn this over to Al.
One comment before we change the slide is, once again, this was taken in those huge trace files using let's call it some power tools, folks.
Yeah.
And being able to crunch that numbers to really look at why, where that firewall was seeing these elongated periods of time where, and the guys from Microsoft just loved it because they were like, we knew it wasn't us, but we couldn't prove it.
Exactly.
We proved it with packets.
Yeah. And to kind of wrap up that story, it ended up being essentially a firmware issue in the firewall. So I won't mention the name of the vendor, but essentially spent multiple hours, gave them the PCAP files, told them which packets to look at within Wireshark, and about 4 weeks later they fixed it. So they were still doing a little bit of queuing, but it was like 5 to 10 milliseconds instead of 2.5 seconds.
Nate, appreciated having that data because once again, it's all there.
Yeah, it's online. And a lot of times you'll hear from vendors. Again, I like to pick on vendors, but you'll hear that, oh, you're the only person having this problem. No other customers are having this issue. And then when you give them the data, you give them the raw, the packets that are not telling, that don't lie, and show it to them, they realize, okay, well, yeah, there is an issue that we didn't see. And a lot of times it's because they haven't done these types of studies, right? They don't, they'll do connection
you know, how many connections can we run and how fast can we set up a connection, but they're not doing the level of stuff that you guys are doing in this class and that we all do as you know, packet analysts.
Thanks, Mike. Yeah. So real quick, let's go through here. Earlier today, Ross had that session on TLS. And what we're seeing in a big way now is to solve those network application performance management problems. You know, we need to see that 1460 of user data, the actual data that those typical, you know, 15, 18 packets carry. So we need to decrypt. And once again, in Ross's session earlier this morning, he spoke to, you know, decryption and how it works and did a great job. So just want to kind of touch upon some solutions where we could do that. We're in line because everything we're seeing today with the modern browsers is TLS 1.3, right? Diffie-Hellman. So we need to have a solution in line that, you know, is fault tolerant so we don't, you know, stop production traffic, but can decrypt that data so we can see the application layer when we need to see it. So a number of solutions from companies like A10, as well Keysight, Ixia, and as well like your third generation, you know, firewalls. You can, you know, once again, Mike's point earlier, do I really want to do packet captures on my firewall? Do I really want to do decryption on my firewall? Maybe not, but ad hoc, when I'm in fire and, you know, C-level's yelling at me to solve this problem, I may have to turn that feature on. So there's a lot of ways to get to that, you know, actual data when you need to see it. And the folks from ProfiTap out there who are one of our presenters here today also have some great solutions that you can, you know, decrypt the data and actually see it and present it to your tool, like an IOTA or to, you know, other packet capture stream to disk tools that give you that back in time capability, or just, you know, if you want to, once again, use Wireshark and TCP dump, or, you know, however you want to capture those packets. I just kind of wanted to show you that because that's prevalently happening in our environments these days. You know, the app teams will come to me and say, hey, I know it's not the network, but I can't figure out where the application's failing, you know, and I'm like, hey, it's encrypted. You've encrypted it. So I need to see the data and we need tools to be able to do that.
Yeah. And the other thing I'll add to that too, Al, is that if you're going to be in attendance tomorrow, go sit in on Chris Greer's Quick class. Anybody gotten familiar with Quick, the QIC protocol? It's all encrypted, running over UDP. So application visibility is, you know, again, we're network engineers. Why do we care about applications? Primarily because we have the tool set to give them the visualization of how is the application affecting the network? And more importantly, how is the network affecting application latency, bandwidth, congestion? And, you know, there's so many poorly written applications that, you know, a lot of times it isn't the network. And when it isn't, you typically have to prove what it is. So decryption is going to be more and more important within the next couple of years, especially when Microsoft gets SIFs running over Quick. It's gonna dominate the market. So,
yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate you coming.